Our next speaker is Mr. Jacques Gilbert, who is with he's with DuPont. He is the technical marketing manager for building innovations for Europe, Middle East, and Africa. And thank you for joining us. He's going to talk about some of the new technologies and also touch upon the coming codes as they relate to the Energy Performance Directive. So, Jacques.
Thank you, Stephen. It's a pleasure to be with you today here in Bucharest. From what I can see from the audience, the meal was not too heavy, so most of you are still alive. And I hope I will continue to keep you awake. So maybe a few words about DuPont, the company I'm representing today. DuPont is a quite old company, an industrial company providing mainly raw materials to the industry. And quite unusually, that company is mostly known to women and ladies because of the famous invention of nylon lycra and other fantastic fibers, which made the success of DuPont in the 20th century. Now we are moving to new challenges in our company regarding the topic we are discussing today. One of the main themes of all the research which is happening right now in DuPont is to try to move from oil, for instance, which is becoming scarce these days, to the plants. And why moving from oil to the plants? Because at DuPont we make a lot of plastics, and all of these plastics are made out of oil. So we believe that the future will be to make plastics out of plants, which we are doing already today, so we have already some products on the market. Now, talking about energy efficient building, it's a topic I like a lot. I've been working in the construction industry for DuPont in the last 10 years. And I will come back a little bit to some of the topics which have been already discussed today, so it will not be new to you. I will come back to the European Directive on Energy Efficiency, talk a bit about the energy balance and the certificate of energy, which is a reality today. It's not science fiction anymore. And then I will be very practical, talking a bit about some technology and products and some topics like air tightness, thermal insulations. This morning, some person talked about the problem of sick air syndrome. We are moving to it if we don't pay attention by over-insulating our buildings, so I will discuss that a little bit. And then I will talk about a topic which is undiscussed yet today, bioclimatic approach in designing building. And then I will present you a very brief theoretical case study to show you that on a small building, you can really achieve a lot of savings in terms of energy. So coming back to the European Directive, this is really, for me, a revolution in the way of designing building. Why? Simply because this new frame for calculation and designing building is a total revolution for the designer. In the past, we used to design building per elements. So there were codes saying you need this specification for a door, this specification for a window, this specification for a roof. Now, the directive is asking for a global calculation. We have to calculate the total energy consumption of a building. This is totally new. Why is that so important? Many people have discussed more or less about this topic already today. The certificate of energy for me will be the driver to move the efficiency really to a better level. Why? Simply because this will become part of the equity of the building. This will make sensitive all the user that the building they are living in or they are buying has a value in terms of energy. Today, energy is a matter for specialists, discussed in Congress like here, but the man in the street is not really facing this topic today. Now I can see in country where I live, in Luxembourg, they are implementing right now the introduction of the certificate of energy, so every building which will be rented, sold, renovated, or asked permission for construction will need a certificate of energy. And the certificate of energy will not be just a paper made with some calculation. For all building, it will represent the actual consumption of the building. So there will be no way of cheating, and I really believe this will be a driver for improvement. The EU objective was mentioned before, quite challenging, improving the energy efficiency by 20%, increasing the amount of renewable energy to 20%. This is quite a challenge. The long term, I think, is to build positive energy building or zero energy building in the worst case in the future. If we look at the way now the European directive is asking to do the energy balance of building, this represents in a simplified way the different things the designer has to estimate when he does the energy balance of a building. And as you can see, On this chart, there are a part which counts for the losses and a part which counts for the gains. And the sum of the two, hopefully, will be in the future positive or zero. But for the time being, it's unfortunately we have much more losses than we have gains. This, as you will see in the next chart, when you look at the scale of energy consumption for building, it can go from zero up to more than 500. As you can see, this is one way of representing it. This is the way they do it in Germany. There are different ways of doing it. But more or less, they are copying what has been done already for electrical appliances to show on a scale the performance of the building or the performance of an electrical appliances or a car. Most countries in Europe are talking kilowatt hours. Some countries, they are on an island on the other side of the channel. They like to talk more about CO2 emission, and so they count the kgs of carbon emission, but it's the same thing at the end. And as you can see, you can have really huge difference in buildings. You can have a building rated 400 or you can have a building rated 50. There's a huge difference between the two. There's a factor 8. So it's quite, the technology is there to make really dramatic changes. This chart I thought is quite interesting to show you. It's an historical chart for the city of Zurich in Switzerland. And as you can know, the Swiss are not the last one to make progress in energy efficiency. Showing the energy efficiency of the buildings in the city of Zurich. On the y-axis, you see the amount of energy consumed per square meter of building. And then you see the evolution over the years. And you see it's quite high level up to the 1970s when we reached the first oil crisis. And since that time, you see the curve is going down. The chart was made in 2000. And you can see at that time the level was at 100. And the Swiss believe that by 2050, and that was fought in 2000, they would be below 50. So as you can see, all new buildings, basically starting from now, will have a good efficiency. So now, if Europe wants to meet the Kyoto Protocol and reach all the targets we have set, you see that the biggest target is to work on renovation, because that's where you have the biggest amount of square meters which have a poor efficiency. So another important topic now, if you want to improve the energy efficiency of building, is air and moisture management. Usually in commercial buildings, it was presented this morning, these buildings are designed by engineering office. They take into account all of these issues. But for residential building, and that's where most of DuPont has its business today, in residential building, it's not so sophisticated. So the tendency would be, okay, let's make it more efficient by increasing the amount of insulation, making the building airtight, reducing thermal bridges, increasing the amount of insulation. Fine, but then you would basically put the building into a plastic bag and you would very quickly get a problem with the air quality. So building tight, yes, but ventilate right is as much important. On this topic, the European Commission there are codes in preparations, but I think they are far behind what is being done on the insulation part. It's difficult in a residential building to make airtight all the connections you can get in the building. For instance, if you have a timber frame structure like you can see on this house connecting to the wall, which are masonry, if you don't pay attention, you will have small gaps where the air can go through. So paying attention to those details is really the solution to make a much better building. So the first thing for the designer when he's thinking to make an airtight building is to think to design what are my control planes. So where are the surface I want to make airtight? If you want to keep the attic ventilated, you're going to make the airtight level at the ceiling level. If you want to use the attic as to make rooms, then you're going to make the airtight plane will be set into the roof structure. Another concept to achieve this type of efficiency is to think of what the English call robust details. And this is coming more and more in the design. Is instead of thinking, okay, I'm gonna sell this element or this other element for the building and put them together, God knows who, how. Let's think about how to put together the material in a way that it is being efficient. Let's think about certifying systems, assembly of materials which are working in a consistent way with good performance. This concept is used already, for instance, in acoustic, but is appearing more and more in the thermal insulation domain. Now, another important part and consequence of the energy directive from the European Union is to make sure that it works. It's nice to design airtight, it's nice to design with a good insulation, but at the end, does it work? And for airtightness, there's only one way to know whether it works. It's to make a pressure test. And these pressure tests are standardized. They are common in the US as well as in Europe now. You see companies making these tests flourishing a bit everywhere now. The concept is very simple. You open the door, you put a big fan with a sealing system, and then you put pressure, 50 Pascal, and you measure the leaks. Gives you an idea of what is the air exchange rate due to the gaps and cracks I was mentioning before. Now, there are building codes, more and more setting standards for this, and but the big problem is this costs money. That's why, as I was mentioning before, if we can get to a situation where people are building consistently with using these robust details, we can probably avoid in the future to systematically test all buildings. Another issue regarding building efficiency, this is quite technical, but I will try to be very simple, is the problem of increasing the R value. The R value is a value which characterizes the heat insulation performance of the building envelope. If you want to get R value above 5 and try to reach to the 10, you get into thickness which are going close to the 40-50 centimeter. This starts to become impractical, especially if you want to go higher. There are new materials in the labs of certain people, not in DuPont, I can tell you, which are much more performing. And that's the light blue curve, as you can see. This is really completely a rupture in the technology, but these materials do not exist only in the lab. If they come to life one day, it will really help a lot to significantly further reduce the this problem of thickness versus insulation efficiency. Another way to improve the insulation of building is to use a complement of insulation. Traditional insulation is usually fiber, glass fiber, all kinds of fibers, all kinds of plastic foams, but these materials alone, they can do a certain job for a given thickness, as I mentioned before. If you combine them with metallized membranes, which brings other functionality like airtightness and also breathability, which you need to prevent condensation to accumulate in the building envelope, then you can further expand the thermal performance of those traditional insulation products. Another concept, which is quite new, it's something we are promoting since 2 or 3 years now, is the concept of thermal mass. Traditional buildings, especially in Europe, much more than the United States, are made out of thick stone walls, which have a lot of thermal inertia. So in summertime, everybody likes to go in these buildings because they remain cool. Now, if you make something different today using steel structure or timber frame structure, this building heats up very quickly. Unless you have an air conditioning with a set point on 20 degrees, then you don't feel the difference, but you can read your electrical counter going quite fast. So one way to improve the situation is to bring artificially thermal mass into the building, and we have for that purpose developed a new material. It's a combination of a paraffin, which is a phase change material. So it's the same concept of putting a glass, a block of ice in your soda or in your orange juice in summertime. As long as the ice is melting, you keep a low temperature. The material we have designed is a 5 millimeter plate, like a gypsum board plate, contains 60% of a material which is melting at 22 degrees. The secret, it's melting but doesn't leak out because it is contained by a polymer. Using this kind of material in buildings which have a low inertia, of course, doesn't make sense to use it in a building with 50 centimeter stone wall, can reduce your energy bill by 15% in winter and up to 35% in summer in combination with an air conditioning unit, for instance. Now, I want to complete my presentation with a very simple case study for a very small house, so nothing comparable to all the big buildings and the big projects that have been presented today. But I want to show you that on a very small house compared to a big commercial building, and I took the climatic condition of Bucharest, for a 160 square meter house, two-story. If you take the way you were building in the 90s, These are the parameters I took from the building codes, the Romanian building codes from the 90s. And you look at what you could be doing today in terms of improvement, it can be really dramatic. First of all, if you look at the situation for these conditions of the 90s, with the high air exchange rate, so the high leakage of the building, as you can see, 45% of the heating energy was lost due to air exchange rate. So it's quite a bit, it's almost half of it. The other half is basically lost through the roof, through the walls, through the windows. And so working on all the different parameters can really help to bring this whole energy balance down. So as a proposed improvement for the sake of the exercise, I propose to reduce the U value, so to increase the insulation thickness to a level which is normally used today in, let's say, Western Europe. I take the assumption that the building was built airtight and that the windows were using double glaze panes. The result is reduction of heating energy by more than 3. So it means if you heat the building with oil, you can save about 3,000 liters per year. And in terms of carbon emission, it means you can save more than 9 tons. So if you multiply those 9 tons by all these buildings, at the end it becomes a huge number. So my conclusion, I want to remind you that energy efficiency now has become really important. The certificate of energy performance will really become a driver for changing the things, because construction industry has a lot of inertia, and unless the politics are pushing to change, nothing will change. That's what I believe. I've given you some ideas of what are your objectives and what is the frame of reference now. So changing from a single element approach to a holistic approach. I've shown you how to build energy efficient building, mainly residential building, focusing on air tightness and focusing on the correct use of thermal insulation. And then finally, I showed you with a very simple case study that with the current technology, reducing significantly the energy used in building is not science fiction, and it can be done very easily. Thank you for your attention.